How's everybody doing? Are you as nervous as me? Probably not. So today I'm going to talk to you about how to be a technology innovator without an engineering degree or Asperger's. If you look at something from one angle long enough, it becomes very difficult to see it from a different perspective. Check out this picture. This is a burr. It's one of those prickly plants that get stuck to your clothes when you're walking outside. But what if you could look at the burr and think of Velcro? The burr was the inspiration for the creation of Velcro. I try to think like this whenever I learn about a new technology or about how anything in the world works. How can one thing, one technology, be applied to something else in the world? An example is, a while back, I learned about a new waterproof film for electronics, and I applied this exercise. Where else in the world might a waterproof film be useful? Then I realized if you could stick a waterproof film into shampoo, you could eliminate umbrellas. Now, I have no idea if this is scientifically plausible, but it seems like a cool idea, and it's worth exploring, right? If you open your mind, you can come up with really creative ideas by connecting objects and technologies that on the surface seemingly have nothing to do with each other. Here's another example. This is the Breathe Right nasal strip. This was created by a Disney Imagineer, not a doctor. And one night he went to sleep and his nose was stuffy. And he realized that if you lift the skin on your nose, you can breathe clearly. And so he invented a strip that does just that. And the result is a multi-million dollar product. Space elevators, energy derived from water, food that is synthesized from boxes of carbon and oxygen. These kind of all seem like crazy ideas, but maybe these ideas just haven't been fully explored yet. We live in a world where we are divided by skill set according to our educational backgrounds and the letters next to our names, like PhD and MD. These people are considered the experts in their fields, and so naturally, one would assume that the people that know the most about their fields will be the innovators within their fields. And oftentimes they are. But these people are also hindered sometimes because they know too much. They've been trained to think in a certain way, and so their knowledge and expertise in a field is thus narrowly tied to their own experiences and to what they've been taught. And in this way, people are sometimes trained to think inside of the box. Experts often look at problems from the same viewpoint that it becomes almost impossible for them to see it from a different perspective. And in fact, it creates a cognitive dissonance or a discomfort in all of us when we're forced to view things in a way in which we're not used to. So in other words, by virtue of having perspective, we lack perspective. And this phenomenon greatly hinders technological innovation and creativity. And so it's no coincidence that most great discoveries were made by people early in their careers. It's no coincidence that most Nobel Prize winners came up with their groundbreaking research during or soon after their graduate studies, and yet these people are often not awarded their big prizes until decades after their research, until the implications of their research are in common use. So I propose that it's the people who don't look at new fields with a jaded eye, who are not tied to 5, 10, 20 years of training, who are able to come in and look at a problem from an entirely fresh perspective. They can come in with a fresh way of looking at problems, departing from the traditional approaches that have been followed by the experts. And without constraints of an ingrained framework, they can look at problems without decades of prejudice and be able to come up with big connections between objects and technologies that seemingly have nothing to do with each other. So last October, while I was an undergrad at Penn, I came up with a way to wirelessly transmit power through the air in just 2 days, just by thinking about the problem differently and by asking a lot of questions. I was not an engineer, and I did not have Asperger's. My experience has shown me that there is a lot of creativity in this world that is not being harnessed because people don't have the right letters next to their names, and because people are too afraid to push forward their ideas that can't possibly work because they thought of it. When I looked at my wireless laptop with a 15-foot wire dangling from its power socket, I wondered, how could I get rid of that cord? How could I beam energy to my computer so that I didn't have to plug it in to charge it? How could I make charging more like Wi-Fi? I began by thinking about objects that beamed energy through the air. I asked really simple questions, things that people in this room probably already know, like how do remote controls work? How do lasers work? How does Wi-Fi work? I Googled the wireless power landscape and realized that there were a few viable solutions, but each solution had its own set of problems that would get in the way of its commercialization. So I realized that you could beam the entire electromagnetic spectrum, which is basically everything from radio waves to gamma waves. But the right half of the spectrum was too dangerous to beam. You know, you wouldn't want x-rays whizzing through your body just to be able to charge your cell phone. And the left half of the spectrum was either too inefficient or too tightly regulated by the government. So I had to approach the problem creatively. I looked into harnessing the energy from vibrations that constantly surround us, like the road bumps you feel in your car. But how could my electronic devices harness this energy? I knew that no one would want to stick a shaker to the back of their phone or stick bulky energy harvesting plates in their shoes. So I had to figure out a way to send vibrations through the air. And then I realized sound does that. Sound travels through the air by vibrating air particles. And because sound is a form of energy, you could harness the vibrational energy of sound. So I started doing research on ultrasound because it was too high in frequency for you to be able to hear it. And in my research, I learned that ultrasound was used to create acoustic weapons. So I figured that if there was enough energy from ultrasound to create a bomb, you could probably charge your cell phone with it. So how does a paleobiology major at Penn learn how to convert ultrasound into electricity? Well, I literally just Googled it, and I found a... And I found a material that did just that. So this is less than 48 hours after the original idea of creating wireless power. Ultrasonic wireless power. It seemed like an awesome idea, but I figured that if I thought of it, there was no way it could work. Why hadn't somebody else thought of it before? Why hadn't the ultrasound expert thought of it before? I didn't know enough about the technology to determine if it could work or not, and I was a little hesitant to tell any real engineers about it, because honestly, I thought they would laugh at me. I thought they would think that I was stupid. But about a week or so later, I decided to tell my physics professor about the idea. And when I did, he told me that it wouldn't work, that there was no way that I could get enough energy out of ultrasound to be able to charge a cell phone. I was crushed, but I kept thinking about that acoustic bomb. I knew that I needed to do more research, so I read paper after paper on ultrasound, and I devised the basic system. I tried to teach myself as much as I possibly could. I was reading electrical engineering for dummies and begging professors to teach me extra concepts after class. And as outlandish as it sounds, I decided to submit the idea to the Penn Invention Competition. I ordered a few ultrasonic transmitters and receivers online and got an electrical engineering student to help me wire a few things together. We were able to prove that you could beam a tiny amount of power over about an inch. This was enough to keep me going. We won the student invention competition, and a few days later, I was told that Walt Mossberg, the senior technology columnist for the Wall Street Journal, wanted to speak to us. This was crazy. He told us that if we could build a real prototype of this technology, we could demo it at his annual tech conference. Now, at the time, I didn't know much about Walt or his D conference, but I soon learned that this was the premier tech conference of the year, that this is where Steve Jobs debated Bill Gates. I knew I needed to get to this conference, but I had absolutely no idea if I could really build it. I had 1 month. The race was on. So to make this thing work, I had to scale it up from basically what was a tiny little toy to a decent-sized prototype. Now remember, I was the idea person. You know, I could tell you about the science and how it works, but I had absolutely no idea how to wire anything together. So I found an engineer in Indiana, and I begged him to help me build this prototype. I simplified the design using off-the-shelf parts, and we worked together day and night for 2 straight weeks over the phone building this prototype, and we finished it just 2 days before the conference, and I got it working only 10 minutes before I had to demo it the first time. Talk about anxiety. But it worked, and that was so cool. We beamed energy over 3 feet and added about 30 times the amount of power that we got out from the initial proof of concept model. The conference was an enormous success. but it surprisingly spurred a lot of anger and criticism from real engineers. They told me that it could never work on a larger scale, that there was no way that you could actually use ultrasound to charge a cell phone, that what I was trying to do was impossible. But I also knew that no one could really determine if the technology could work or not, because the technology didn't exist yet. And what I had shown there on the D stage was using off-the-shelf parts. We hadn't even tried to push it further. And I kept hearing the same story about how one person would say something was impossible and then somebody else would figure it out. But despite my optimism, I still felt insecure because so many people were trying to knock me down. So I flew around the country talking to the top professors in acoustic research, and I was happy to find that most of them thought it could work, but with a few questions. And probably the biggest nagging question was, if this thing could work, why hadn't it been done before? And it also seemed that for every positive opinion I got, there was another negative one. I couldn't believe how there were such different opinions by experts in the same field. But despite my frustration, this was a very important lesson for me to learn. This taught me to be skeptical of experts, that expertise represented a narrow way of looking at things, and that experts knew what they knew based on their own prior studies. And since ultrasonic wireless power didn't exist yet, no one had prior studies with it, so no one could really determine if this could work on a larger scale. And nobody really fully understood the problem, and so no one could accurately answer my questions. I realized that it was up to me to solve it. And this was a very daunting prospect, considering my scientific background was at the undergraduate level, and my engineering was largely self-taught. So asking seven people the same question and averaging the answer was a very inefficient way about doing things, but it did push the concept forward. And the further that I dug into the technology and the theory, and the theory behind it, the more complex the technological hurdles became. And with each new hurdle, another engineer would tell me, it's not going to work. But because I already learned to not trust one person's opinion, I became immune to the naysayers. For each technological hurdle deemed insurmountable by the experts, I would spend just a few hours thinking about the problem from a variety of approaches. As Steve Jobs said, I had to think differently. So I found solutions based on the acoustics of musical instruments, based on other technologies, and from basic research such as from authoritative sources such as Wikipedia. And when I would present my progress to the engineers, they'd say, yeah, that could work. So I was able to solve problems when the PhD experts couldn't, with just a few hours of really simple research. Every single argument over why the technology couldn't work has been indisputably wrong. And for every objection that's been raised, I have found solutions. This was another very important lesson for me to learn. Engineers are inherently linear thinkers and tend to take a very binary approach to solving problems. When faced with a problem, they think, can this work or can this not work? But I would think, how can I make this work? As a non-expert, I had an advantage because I could look at a problem from different angles because I just didn't know what was possible. Being naive is sometimes a good thing, because without constraints, the world is truly your oyster. Now, this is not to say that experts are unnecessary. That is entirely false. Experts are extremely critical in carrying scientific visions forward and driving ideas to reality. And now, 8 months later, I have four of the top ultrasonic engineers in the world working for me, or working with me, and developing my prototype according to my design. It's going to work, and it's going to be awesome, and I can't wait to give the middle finger and smile to all the engineers that criticize the crap out of me. My experience also made me wonder, how many game-changing, brilliant ideas out there thought of by laypeople, teenagers, store clerks, paleobiologists, have been squashed by experts that said, that can't work? I know that if I weren't as stubborn as I am, I would have chucked this entire idea 8 months ago because I was told that my idea was impossible. But by thinking differently, by thinking outside the box, by thinking around corners, you can outthink the top thinkers. They say that the most revolutionary ideas in the world were considered crazy up until the point that they became revolutionary. The world was flat. The Earth was at the center of the universe. Electricity could never be tamed, and ultrasound can't charge your iPhone. But that was then, and this is the future. So dream out loud, ask questions, take risks, never give up, keep pushing, and believe in yourself even when no one else does.